Test the sound. Do you want to move the mic?
Yeah. I'll try and get a little bit closer to you.
This is so scary.
Scary.
Just imagine I'm not here.
Do you know?
I'm invisible.
Do you know that, and I warn you about this, that Simon has this kind of invisibility cloak.
Oh, yes.
And I belong to the NCT, do you know, the National Childbirth Trust? And I joined a group when my son, when I was pregnant with my son, and he's now 34, so that tells you how long ago I've known these ladies. And periodically they meet up, and they came round to mine for tea. And I thought it would be nice, because some of them are now grands, and I thought it would be nice to have a tea in which we could talk over what it was like when we were, you know, young mothers and newly pregnant and whatever, and you know, all the things that have happened over the time. Now, if you imagine this group, of course, they've known each other a long time. So there's a lot of water under the bridge. There's a lot of previous, and there's a lot of things known about. And they came down and they came to tea. And I asked them the same thing. Yes, it's some stuff for the website would be nice. We'll just cut in some bits. I'll give you, you know, you, if you don't like it, then we throw it away. We don't use it. Absolute permission. You say yay or nay. And here's Simon. He's quite quiet. He's just going to run the camera. Okay, forget, you know, ignore him. And he puts on his invisible, look, I can't see him now. It's completely gone. And anyway, he set up this and we got talking. And we absolutely didn't know he was there, not in the slightest, to the extent that we can't actually use any of the material because it's kind of ex-certificate.
Oh, no.
Everybody got so into talking about everything that we completely never used an inch of it.
Well, you know, Simon, that might be another market.
That could be it.
Turn my phone off.
Yes, my phone's on silent. Where's your phone? Your phone is
bleeping. Absolutely no idea.
Is it in that handbag, Davina? Because something was bleeping up there.
Was it?
Yeah.
Simon, are you needing to set up, start off?
Probably.
Oh no, because I don't know where I'm sitting now.
That's okay, you just sit down and I'll reframe it as sort of where you land.
Okay, well then I'll put these more within reaching distance. So I won't be walking around.
That's going to fall.
Somebody, but I don't think I did.
What's that cushion?
Do you not want it?
It's a bit funny in the camera, so just put it behind you.
Yep.
Yeah, you could see the picture.
Yeah, very good.
So we have an art director as well.
I feel quite redundant.
Great, perfect.
Okay. That's fine. It's very, very important. So, ladies, what would you like me to talk about?
Well, I'm very interested in learning about the labelling on food products. I have no idea what they mean, and I want to know for my own benefit of the things to put back on the shelf and say no way, and the things that maybe are okay.
Mm-hmm.
And even the sort of percentages, which is okay, but some things you know you can have a little bit of, but you don't want too much, like say sugars or something like that.
Absolutely. Well, it's lovely to be able to share what I've found. I'm certainly not a nutritionist and I'm not an expert in any way. My expertise is only my own story and the things that I've learned that have helped me to really overcome my own diabetes and to lose weight. And there have been a lot of things, and actually discovering what's on food labels has been one of them. And so I'm very happy to share that with you, because it's as though it's a mystery, it's a puzzle. It's the code is written there on the food, but if you don't know what it means, well, so what? And actually, the government obliges the manufacturers of food to write and make it clearly put on their products, the percentages of things, how much there is in there. So all the information you could possibly need to help you make choices is already on the food. And the secret about it all is the choices. It's the choices you make, but you can't make a choice unless you are informed about what's in there and how to make a choice or not. And I have to say that when I began this, I thought, how boring. Oh gosh, you know, what a dull thing. What has it come to this? Is this going to be my life, reading food labels? And actually, it's absolutely fascinating. I am now one of these kind of food label geeks, and you'll see me in the supermarket going down and looking at all the labels. And all the things that are written there are really informative. So if we start back, rolling back what you're looking for when you're looking at food labels, and you know about all the major food groups that there are, mm-hmm. you know about carbohydrates, mm-hmm. and you know that what's in also within carbohydrates is sugar. Mm-hmm. And from a diabetic point of view, the sugar is really, really important, because when you take sugar in, you know that that affects your blood sugar level, but also when you take carbohydrates, because carbohydrates turn automatically into sugar in the bloodstream. So that's what you do. You're just wrapping it up a little bit differently and delaying the process a little bit before you're taking in more sugar. So it's really important. And so when you see a food label, it will be written on there, it says carbohydrates, and it says of which sugars. And so there's a percentage of that. You can see that something is, and sometimes you'll be horrified to see that actually the whole thing of it, all the carbohydrates are in fact sugar. And starting to think about the different food groups, there's something called the Eat Well plate. Have you ever heard of this?
Is that where you have percentages of food?
That's right, that's right. Yeah. It's like an ordinary dinner plate, mm. and it's divided up into 5 portions. And it's recommended by the Department of Health that a healthy meal would look like one of these Eat Well plates. You would be eating well if you had this. It was kind of rather surprising when I thought about what my plates looked like and what this plate looked like. And the biggest section of this, which is almost a third for a healthy person, is made up of fruit and vegetables. That's it. A third of the plate. And you look at your plate and you think, is that a third? And by the way, potatoes isn't part of that. Potatoes is in the carbohydrate, absolutely, in the carbohydrate section. So that means this is all salads and vegetables and so on, and fruit. And you know, there's the government recommendation, which everybody knows.
5 a day.
That's right. Well, that's what it used to be, but actually it's not just 5 a day. What it says is at least 5 a day, and now many other countries, including the States, and I believe a number of countries in Europe as well, are recommending that it should be 7 a day. So you just have to say, how many did I have of those portions today?
And what is a portion?
Ah, yes, and then you come into, you know, there's another whole ball game there as to what a portion is. Very simple rule of thumb is a portion is approximately a fist, so.
Right.
About that, and it depends again what it is. So like with nuts, you'd only just have a little what would be in the palm of your hand, mm-hmm. and you'd be looking. So if you're looking for if you're a meat eater, then you're looking sort of that size of a portion, as opposed to a steak that hangs over both sides of the plate, you know. Mm-hmm. So these sections are fruit and vegetables, and that's if you're a healthy person and you're just wanting to maintain your weight, you'd want a third of the plate of mm-hmm. fruit and vegetables. If you are, and this is the British Diabetic Association that suggests this, and it makes a different configuration of this plate, and its recommendation is that if you have either diabetes 1 or diabetes type 2, that you would be having half of that plate of just fruit and vegetables. And of the other 4 sections, there is the next section after that would be carbohydrates. And that's all the things you know about, the pasta and rice and the different grains and so on. And what's recommended out of those is that it would be whole grain. Chips would belong in there, but obviously be a less healthy choice than if it were something else like couscous or some kind of rice or pasta mix. So there's that section, and then the next section below that would be your protein, which would be meat and fish and so on. And if you're vegetarian, like myself, then you would be adding your pulses and also whatever else is your protein content in that, things, soya-based protein, things like corn and those kind of things, which would be your port. But actually, there's a big myth about protein, you know. We all sort of think that we should have enormous amounts of protein, and your body needs very little protein, and nearly everything else has got protein in it, or that which you can use as protein. So you don't need nearly, you know, and it's all habit, you know. And there is this habit, certainly in large parts of the Western world, that about what a vegetarian diet is. They consider that, you know, a healthy meal would be meat and two veg. Therefore, a vegetarian meal is obviously just two veg. And it's not so. You could have a whole plate of many other delicious and different and filling up things. So there's that one as well. So there's the protein. And then the second to smallest section of the Eat Well plate is dairy products. And all, so it's taking up a very small portion of any single Eat Well plate. Small of cheese, small amount of milk, small amount of all of those dairy things. And what do you suppose is in the little tiny, tiny, only about 5 minute portion if it were a clock? What do you suppose that is?
Fats.
And? Sugars. Sugars and fats and oils and those kind of things would be in that little tiny portion. In fact, when I started out on this journey, that's what I would have said, is that's all the things that make life worthwhile, is you know, in that little tiny portion. Is that what my life is being reduced to, this little point? And it seemed impossible to not have those. And by the time you've reduced them from the amount that they did have on my plate to the amount that they now have, which is pretty much non-existent, you really have got used to that idea. And thinking about, you know, we're talking about food labelling, and good to have a look at that. There are three things that make processed food interesting, and as far as manufacturers would consider make it edible and tasty, and you want to have it. And they are?
Sugar, salt,
and?
Fat.
That's it. So those are the ones to be looking for. Those are the things that get put in. And this is where it all becomes interesting, because you think about it, oh, fat, I don't have very much of that. But actually looking at a food label will tell you exactly how much fat there is in anything prepared that you might buy. And it also starts to make you think about what you're cooking. So if you start off everything by putting in 4 ounces of butter and watching it melt while you think of what to cook, then, you know, then it's worth observing that and making different choices. So that fat and sugar and salt, and because these are the things that we've been trained to taste and to appreciate and make us feel, you know, we believe that that's what gives good flavour, that's what we look for with our taste buds, that's what we feel, that's what we taste in things, and so that's what the processed food manufacturers give us. And what is really surprising is to discover the added things that are put in to give that flavour. So quite often, like frozen peas will have had added sugar in it, or some kind of savoury food will have had, you know, a savoury meat thing like a shepherd's pie or something, has got added sugar in it. It's been added in so that it tastes nice. But they have to tell you, so you get to know the secret, and you get to have a look inside, and you get to see what's really being put in there. And what it does is make you empowered, because you then have the power to choose, and you can say, wow, that's huge, an enormous amount of sugar, but that's okay, that's what I'm having today, then that's fine, that's your choice. But when you start to see these proportions, when you start to see what's being put in there, when you start to see what's kind of being slid past you, the other way is, I don't know if you have it here, do you have the traffic light system here on foods?
No, I think that was talk of it.
Okay. Well, I'll just explain a bit about the traffic light system. The idea was that maybe many people would not be prepared to put on their, you know, really close focus specs and look at all the small writing and grids on the back. And so some other easy system should be invented and should be used. And so the idea was that when something was in its the proportion of that particular food group was within its proper range of how much there should be, there would be a green light, a little green symbol. Mm-hmm. And if it was kind of a bit on the edge of what how much is acceptable of that particular food group, there would be orange. And if it was, you know, really this is too much of this, there would be a red light on it. And so you could have the major food groups grouped out like this, and then you would be able to see at a glance. But it's rather fallen out of usage, and most people don't even understand it. So
I think it gets abused as well, does it, by some of the manufacturers trying.
Could well. So all the secrets are there, and I will explain to you about how what that grid is so you can see. And I've gone round your kitchen cupboards and I've pulled out what I can find.
Okay.
No judgment there, but I've just give some examples of
great.
How things
That's
are
good.
And how the thing works. So I've got here a cereal packet, just to show you how it works. So what they are obliged to do on every food label, there will be at least one of the columns that will say, at the top of it, it will say typical value per 100 grams. And the reason for this is that when you've got a base marker, like how much is 100 grams of whatever's in it, then what's the constituent parts of that? Then you can reasonably compare it with 100 grams of something else. Mm. But there may also be another chart down the same side of it over there saying, and it can say all kinds of different things. It can say per the whole of this packet, or in this case of cereal, it says per 30 gram serving, because that's what they are saying is their recommended serving. And that's another fascinating thing. Mm. Have you ever weighed out 30 grams of cereal?
It's very
small. You wouldn't think it'd cover the bottom of a cereal bowl, really.
Yes.
We should get a pair of scales in a minute and weigh out 30 grams and see what it is. Mm-hmm. Because when you do the, you know, tip it over and pour, you probably find that you're getting 50, 60, maybe twice as much of you know, for what's only an ordinary portion of that. Okay, so then you'd have these things going down, which, do you want to look at them?
Yes.
Mm. So you'd start off there with your energy value over there. Okay, so that's your kilojoules or your calories, which you can look at, and some people choose to control their weight by doing calorie counting. I found this make a plate and look at the plate, make a picture of an ideal plate. Mm-hmm. I stick it on my fridge. You can Google and download it, you know, just go eat well plate, and what comes up is the picture of this plate and the relative values of what needs to be on your plate. And you can even do the taste, you know, the test. I used to run my plate underneath the fridge picture and see whether it looked anything like it, and you know, how come all the potatoes are piled up hugely there and there's not very much greenery and fruit and so on. Okay, so the next thing that's got that has been written here is the fat content. And I'm not going to go into fats to explain, because it's quite a complicated thing. We can do that on another day, because there are trans fats. You know how to recognize trans fats? They're solid at room temperature. So those are the fats that you should try and avoid. So think of what fats are solid at room temperature.
Butter.
Yep.
Lard.
Yep.
Margarine.
Yep.
Ghee.
All of those.
Yes.
And that's your trans fats.
Mm.
What about coconut?
Well, coconut's one, it's interesting, because a lot of people swear by using coconut oil for cooking and for eating and so on. And I believe there's a lot of people who really think it's great stuff, and it's nice taste as well, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I think, nutritionally speaking, the jury's out as to whether that's it, because it's kind of partly a liquid and partly a solid, isn't it?
Mm.
The other fats which are definitely okay for you are the ones, or relatively speaking, when we're talking about the proportion of fat that you have, are the ones that are liquid at room temperature, which are
Olive oils, yes.
The olive oils and so on. And there's another whole debate about that, but, you know, what's in those oils, where they come from and so on like that. That need not detain us, but so basically making, if you are using fat, if you are using fat, and the amount of the portion of fat that's recommended per meal is 5 grams. Have no more than 5 grams
per meal.
Yeah. And the portion of carbohydrates for that's recommended is between 45 and 60 grams.
Right.
And if you start weighing up, then you guys get fascinated. I had my scales out and was measuring and weighing everything. You very soon get to know how much that means,
yeah.
and getting good. But it's very empowering to be able to see it. I've got fibre here, they've got protein here, and that's in a, those are the two paired columns, the 100 grams and the 30 grams. There's all your vitamins and so on. And one of the little secrets about what gets hidden away is, now here it's just, it just says so, and it's owning up, and it says salt content. But sometimes something with quite high salt content is disguised as, and they call it sodium, because salt is sodium chloride, and so they write it down as sodium. So for a lot of people, they wouldn't know what that was. They would, you know, think, well, maybe that's, but it's actually, it's the disguise word for salt. And for certain kind of heart conditions and so on, it's obviously important for some people. And what you eat and what you take in of each of these different food groups very much depends on what your condition is. And so obviously I had to look at sugar intake and carbohydrates. And for other people, that might not be an issue. And there may even be some people, and I've met them, whose medical condition or long-term condition required them to put on weight, and therefore they needed to look at things that would actually build their bodies and increase their weight. So it certainly isn't one size fits all. And salt wouldn't be a problem for me, but it might be for somebody who'd got blood pressure problems and so on. And so it's about understanding and then making choice. And the thing about this 100 calories means that what you can do is then look at a different product, which is exactly the same apparent product, but by a different manufacturer or an own brand, and you can compare them. And this was where the amazing thing for me was that an understanding. I would be making a decision. I don't know how you make your decision, but I would be making my decision. Probably first of all on
cost.
Absolutely. You'd say, well, that's interesting. That's, you know, that tin costs so much, this tin costs so much, I'll have
that's
this one.
Right.
And obviously it's all the advertising and it's, you know, whatever. And it wouldn't occur to me that there would be any significant difference in the content of the two products. And it was staggering to discover how different they were. Particularly in something like baked beans. How different can a baked bean be? But I invite you to amaze yourself next time you're in a supermarket to just line up 3 or 4 cans of baked beans, an own brand one, and you know all the known manufacturers, and look at how much there is in the way of sugar, salt, fat. There's only beans in it, for goodness sake. How many more different things can there be? Well, I invite you to look and see. What I found, Sandy, in your cupboard was I found 2 different kinds of oatcakes.
Oh, yes.
And you'd say, okay, oatcakes is oatcakes. But I'll just show you. Oh, there's the traffic lights. Can you see?
Oh, those are them.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, right.
Oh, look. Well, look what's red.
Yeah.
Oh, oh.
What's that one?
Fat.
Fat.
Oh, oh.
Saturates. Sugar's okay on this one. And salt is only so-so.
Yeah.
Yeah? So, you don't have something comparable here, but I chose these because they're the same product. So
yes.
Yeah.
2 kinds of oat cakes.
Okay.
And you see here the comparison. You've got 2 columns. You've got the one is the per 100 grams.
Yes.
And that's the comparable one. And then this one is per oat cake. And this one is also per oat cake. But start off by looking at one difference per oat cake. Each oat cake here is 12.5 grams, and each oat cake here is 10.4 grams.
Right.
So if you were comparing oat cake for oat cake, it wouldn't be a fair comparison because they're different sizes. And
yes.
That's why you need to compare the 100 grams for 100 grams, because then you get a fair comparison. So there's the two of them, oat cakes. How different can an oat cake be? Tastes of dried circle of porridge. Right. Energy content, pretty much the same. Well, not quite. This one's 1947, this one's 1861 kilocalories. And this one's 465 kilocalories, and this one's 444. Now start going down. The fat content in this one is 19 grams.
19 grams.
And the fat content in this
17.
One is 17 grams. So you already have a difference in the content of the fat. Of which saturates?
4.8.
4.8, that's your solid at room temperature. 3.4. And as you go down, carbohydrates, 60, comparable for 59.
Yeah.
Of which sugars?
Two grams.
Two grams. Of which sugars?
0.8.
Isn't it interesting?
Such a difference, yes.
Protein content equivalent, salt content?
1.7 and then 1.6.
This is, I think it's 1.2 there.
Oh, sorry.
1.2 or 1.6. So what I'm saying, it becomes fascinating to be able to compare two things that you've thought, you know, what things could be more similar, and yet they're actually very different.
So
and then you start.
The green pack is better for you, is it?
It would seem so.
Yeah.
But then you maybe make other choices. You make choices on price. You make choices on taste. Maybe the whole family love those and whatever.
Yeah.
It's not about dissing any particular kind of food. It's like saying you're making a choice and you're saying they're so delicious. I will take the little hit on the something or other because I'll have fewer of them. And it's of how many you eat as well. And then the thing, if you really want to play this game, you move on to the more advanced thing, which is taking something which is your favourite most things that you love most in all the world. I noticed this one has been ripped open in enthusiasm by whoever, and it's some kind of crisp. Again, you can do the comparison test, but just it's a bit crumpy, so I don't know if I can very much see that. How this is per 100 grams, and this is per portion. So of the fat content is
29.9, almost 30.
A third of the pack is fat.
That's right.
Saturated.
And per, it says 37.7, it tells you each 37 gram serving. Now, again, it's really worth weighing out what 37 grams of crisps look like and whether you would call that a serving or not.
Okay.
And that would be how much in fat?
11.1
grams.
Yeah.
Of which your portion of fat is to be?
Oh, very small.
5 grams. No
grams.
More than 5 grams.
Yes.
So you've done 2 days' worth in a bag of crisps.
A bag, and it's not even a bag, is it?
In a bag.
It's a small bit of that bag.
I have here some secret supplies. I'm sure this belongs to someone else. I'm sure this isn't yours. But if you want to look at what the nutritional information is on a bar of chocolate.
Is there any...
100 grams. What's yours got? I've got 100 grams.
Of energy or fat?
Fat.
That is
25.7. Oh, right. And so it's 15, is that? No, 35.3. So a lot more, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And that was of which the saturated?
15.7.
So this is 16.5.
And carbs are 60.5.
49.
And sugars are 55.9.
48.
protein is 5.4.
1.7. Oh no, sorry, that was fibre. The protein is 8.8. And then salt.
Salt is 0.36.
0.2. Mm.
It's interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
And you can play this game, game anyone can play, to be able to, you can see how empowering it is to be able to then look at things, and you've got all the information that you need there, that you could see different ways, and there's a can of, it's Weight Watchers beans, so it'd be interesting to observe how much there is of all the things that you're
Let's see. Okay, so typical 100 grams, the fat is
0.7 or 0.2, to put it further away from
me. Yeah, 0.2, that's right. Of which saturated a trace, carbohydrate is 11.3, of which sugars
3.5.
Quite
a lot of sugars for the beans.
It is, isn't it?
And it's when they write and say that something is reduced sugar, it only has to be a reduction of what they put in the one that they don't call reduced.
Right.
So there isn't any kind of standard of what, meaning it's less than a certain percentage or something. It's just a way of saying, so you go, oh, reduced sugar. That obviously doesn't mean it's got any sugar in it at all. And all it actually means is that it's less than the one that you would have bought if you didn't have reduced written on it. So it's worth having a look at that. And it's just another tool for...
That is a 200 tin, right? 200 gram tin. And this is for a portion of 100 grams. So if you were to eat it all, you'd get... 3.2 grams of sugar, of salt. That's what's killing me. Look at that. Salt.
And you would have to watch salt.
1.2.
So do you think that's useful to look at, to be able to look at the labels? Do you think you'd be able to?
Well, I think that I remember seeing you do that.
Mm.
And to become conscious, and obviously after a while you don't need to, because you know, but I did not realise about that traffic light system.
Mm-hmm.
I see it all the time, and I never knew about it.
So that can give you a kind of ready retina, because you can see if it's red of anything, or red of salt, and you're looking out the salt, obviously it's a thing you don't have to do. And where it took me, this is where I began, was looking at the things that I was already eating, buying and eating.
Mm-hmm.
And it took me to a place of looking at, you know, all this stuff has been in some way processed, that's what they call it, processed. It's been through a process. And if you think about food when it comes from nature, it never has any labels on it.
Mm-hmm.
You don't see something saying reduced sugar strawberry. You don't see, you know, no salt lettuce. And it moved me towards a diet increasingly made of just natural foods. And that started by cooking with ingredients, so doing the processing, whatever processing was happening, I was doing it myself. So I knew how much salt was going in, and deciding not to cook with it, which you hardly taste at all, and leave it on the table, and if it felt not salty enough, adding it on then.
Mm-hmm.
And then trying to do less and less of that processing.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you imagine, if you think of a kind of continuum, of which one end is something that you bought in a supermarket that has been prepared, frozen, and you know, has been in your freezer, and how many processes that's gone through, and what's been added to it, and what you'd have to do. And looking at the other end of it, saying, I went out into the garden and pulled that up, or I stood under an apple tree and I just turned it and it fell into my hand. You can see that the nearer it is to the place where nature grew it and delivered it to you without any labels on, it's got to be better for you, hasn't it? It's got to be more alive. And it is that. It is that feeling when you... that's my experience of eating... fresh food and raw food, is that it feels like you're not only getting the nutritional value, which can be counted by the clever people who work out what these numbers are, mm-hmm. but just anybody can just taste it. You can taste that there's like a life in it, and it's still there. It's still there when you eat it, and mm-hmm. it's going to you, and you've got that life and energy. And your body isn't having to sift through all these other E numbers and proportions of this and that and the other. It's it's just there and it's natural, and you can eat as much of it as you like.
Yeah.
And some adjustment is needed, you know, if you're very used to eating processed food or if you're used to cooking. But there's a lot of stuff that actually is not true, that's up here as old memories or old prejudices or old habits, which is just not true. So one's the great protein story about how much huge amounts of protein you need, and another is about how you need to have warm food to keep you warm. That one, how can that be? You can only take it in at the temperature that your tongue will bear, and it goes down into your stomach, which amazingly brings all your food to the same temperature, regardless whether it was, you know, a cucumber or whether it was, you know, hot soup. Yeah. So the temperature of the food is neither here nor there. It's only a habit. And, you know, many other habits like this and ideas that it only feels right. I'll tell you one tip I was told that I think is really useful. When looking at this Eat Well plate thing and trying to reproduce these sections on it, I was told that this plate actually is supposed to refer to a 9-inch plate.
Mm-hmm.
You think, 9-inch plate, my plates are. I have this lovely dinner service that
you do.
And so measure your plate and see.
Yeah.
So if you start heaping things up on a small plate, it actually gives your mind the illusion, the satisfaction, oh, I have a heaped up plate of food.
Mm.
Change your
plates, that's right.
Yeah. Just take a plate and serve onto that one plate.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, lots of other things like deciding what's going to be on the plate and then having it and that's it. And not doing it into, I'll make enough for everybody, and then, you know, when there's a little bit left over, you know what we mums are like, and just
yes,
I'll just finish off. It's hardly worth putting it onto a saucer and covering it with cling film and putting it in the fridge. I'll just tidy that bit up, just straighten off that edge and tidy that bit up. So one of the rules I got from somewhere else, a very useful tip was, and I couldn't believe it would work because it was so simple, and that was 3 meals a day and nothing in between. And I thought, well, that's crazy, you know. Of course I have that. Of course I do that.
Yes.
And actually, if you look at what you really actually eat, and the way to find this out is with a food diary, which again seems a real fag to do this, real nuisance. But it is hugely revealing. And if you just make a vow to yourself that you're going to, for a couple of days in a couple of weeks, write down every single thing that passes your lips and say, okay, every time something's going in, I'm going to write down what it is.
Mm.
Honestly write down what it is. You get such an information about what you actually eat because you have an idea. I eat 3 healthy meals a day. I don't know how I came to be this size. And actually you find that you eat at different times from what you thought. You eat different quantities from what you thought.
Mm.
And you find out what your own kind of trigger points were. So can be. I would eat healthy meals all through the day, and then, you know, kind of come 6 o'clock, all bets were off. It's evening, fridge raiding time. And if there was like a bowl of nuts out, it's another great weakness. If a bowl of nuts was left out, you know, after, say, people would come around and just have a little bowl of nuts, and I would walk by the dining room table this way and have a few nuts, and then I would walk back the other way and I'd have a few more nuts, and then I'd walk back. And that wouldn't have ever been in my consciousness that I had eaten a whole bag of peanuts. I would, you know, if you asked me and say, what about that whole bag of peanuts? I said, no, not me. But I'd just have taken it. So 3 meals a day and nothing in between. Not even peanuts, not even tidying up, not even.
Right.
Makes a huge difference. So any thoughts or any questions?
There's a lot there already to get started on. And I like the idea of a diary, a food diary, just to kick it off with.
Yeah. To start with, just to get you started, just do 2 days in the week. Pick a day, a weekday, and pick a weekend. Because quite often, what you eat on a weekday and what you eat at a weekend with family getting up, they're quite different. So you can do a comparison of the week and the weekday, and that gives you a good fix.
Yes, and I think it will highlight the time when I'm running to the kitchen, feeling hungry, and feeling I have to eat something, and it's usually what's there, what's easy, you know, and it won't be at all anything good at all. It'll be one of
these. There are lots of things like that, and that's kind of making life easy for yourself, like buying some things and preparing some things that are okay to have if you are a snacker. And I believed, because of my diabetes, that I needed to keep my blood sugar levels up with some substance snack in the day. And so I would make like carrot batons, or very lazily buy carrot batons. I can't tell you what they're charging you for cutting up your carrots for you. Absurd, but or making things that you would eat instead. So that's a possibility. Prepare some stuff for yourself, or kind of mini rice crackers or something. But really with a view to, I don't really need this and I'm moving towards you know, cutting it out.
Yeah.
And it's been found, I think, research has been done that people who want to lose weight, if you keep a food diary, that those are the people who definitely are more likely by a long way to lose weight. So it's just becoming aware, and unless you're prepared to fib to yourself, and there's no point, is there,
are
more likely to lose weight because they're actually becoming aware of those, whatever their trigger points are or weak points. So thank you very much for sitting and listening and
thank you
sharing so those thoughts with me.
Would you keep a food diary?
I have done in the past. I did Weight Watchers. And there's a lot of looking at labels and things in that, and food diaries too.
Is there?
But I think I just like food.
So do I.
It's very hard.
So do
it's one of those things that I think.
And it's finding the thing that
tomorrow. Tomorrow I'll start again. Start very well in the day. Like today I've only had one porridge for my breakfast.
That's great. Do you know, it's another one of the things they found, that if you have breakfast, you're more likely to lose weight if you have breakfast. And I used to go and skip breakfast, go, oh, that's one meal I've, you know, cut out today, good. And all that happens is it sets up a kind of psychological payback called, well, I didn't have any breakfast, so I can have a really good lunch. And by supper time, you're still going, well, I didn't have any breakfast because I'm probably owed a bag of chips or two. Like that. So
are you hungry now?
I had my breakfast, and then I had for lunch, I had a yogurt, and I had 4 Ryvita crackers with butter on.
Right.
I find it hard not to eat butter.
That is a hard one, isn't it? Because it does seem so delicious. But it's been put to me that that was that fats were actually a bigger problem for me than sugar.
Right.
And it collects in your cells, and you have to have given it up for a while before you start really feeling the benefit of that. It's all what you get used to. And all what you
I don't want to replace it with be very dry without some sort of fat on it or something.
Well, there are things
Marmite might like.
Well, something I tell you that I thought was delicious, I still do, is because of that, I need to put something on a cracker because otherwise, is doing something like a ripe avocado, thin slices of ripe avocado with salt and pepper on it. And it's really lovely. And then you've covered the flavour aspect of it, you've covered the protein aspect, and you haven't had any additional fat.
Yeah, that's good, isn't it? To find substitutes. And get used
some
to
people
them.
Like doing bananas, just spread a ripe banana on and just have that. And that becomes the whole meal of that.
Yeah.
And it's also, you know, there's the outside rules like this about, you know, count the numbers and look at the labels and things, but really it's all an inside job, isn't it?
Mm.
It's all about finding that kind of motivating thing.
Mm.
And mine was this doctor, I was telling you about this doctor who told me I couldn't do it.
Yeah.
And the thing that started me off was this doctor saying, you can't do it. No, I doubt it, he said.
Yeah.
And so, you know, miserable and humiliated and pathetic as I felt, there was a little part of me that thought, I'll show you.
Mm.
And I did. The other week I just went back to see him.
Mm.
And he was flabbergasted, amazed, surprised, delighted. Mm-hmm. And he kept saying, I'm impressed, I'm impressed.
Brilliant.
What did you do, he said. He wouldn't listen, I was trying to tell him. But too used to telling people that they can't do it. But it can be done. I think that's really all the reason I'm doing any of this is I really believe it can be done. I know because I've done it. And I've had a huge amount of support and help. I think what's hard is to try and do it on your own.
Yeah.
Because all the things that made you eat more than you need in the first place are still there. So you're fighting all of that. And you're pushing that same challenge uphill.
Mm.
And so what you need to do is do something different. You know, if you do the same things and expect something different to happen,
yes,
it's not going to happen.
Mm.
You need to do different things, change things in some way, and pull in all the support that you can. I was very, very lucky. So first of all, it set off with this doctor telling me I couldn't do it, and I thought, I'll show him. Another thing was my granddaughter being born, and I felt very motivated to live a little longer to enjoy her because she was so fun. And to feel, I'm going to have to get fixed, I'm going to have to push that buggy up that very steep hill in Brighton. And that was another very motivating factor. And it goes from, you have to kind of find that you care about yourself, that you like yourself enough to be healthy with yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'd rather lost that. And lots of things had happened that had made me a bit sad about life and a bit sad about myself.
Mm.
And I needed to work on those and say, you know, you are worth getting healthy. And
yeah.
I had huge amounts of love and support from my sisters. And that was really, really healthy. Helpful and sometimes a real nuisance, because I'd ring them up and I'd want to talk about something and they'd say to me, how's it going, have you done your walking, have you, well that was a